Hi. Content warning, I guess. This video will contain references to and clips of transphobic jokes and archetypes from several different TV shows from throughout the years. If you do not want to see that, sorry.
Howdy, folks. I'm Jenny Geist. I don't know if y'all have heard, but lately I've been really into this popular animated series owned by Disney featuring a character who is trans and blonde called Family Guy. And oh my god, it's a riot.
I love following the adventures of Peter.
Ha ha ha. He's fat.
Cleveland.
He's black.
Joe.
He's disabled.
And Quagmire.
This guy's a fucking racist.
Recently, while scrolling through some of these iconic, crass, rude attitude, Family Guy funny moments, though, I found one that completely and utterly shook me to my core. The show that is infamous for having done this. And this.
Now, Peter, he's not gay. He's a woman stuck in a man's body.
Yeah, gay.
And this, and this, and this.
What are you gonna name you, he, she, father, mother?
When they move to a new place, they're supposed to notify the neighborhood! That's how it works!
He threw up when he found out you were a monster.
You still have bits of penis left.
There's Quagmire and his transgendered mother, which is now gray.
Now, everywhere I go, it's like people are staring at me and whispering. Lord, this time I'm gonna need a chainsaw.
In 2019, that same show produced this.
When I first met you, Peter, I was already at the end of a long journey to find the courage to become a woman. But before that, I lived for 61 years as a miserable, miserable man.
Wait.
I grew up in a small town of Football, Texas.
Are they being legit here?
Then, at the age of 14, I had an epiphany. It was so clear.
Is this real?
I was a girl trapped in a boy's body.
Are they being legit with this?
In those 47 years, I became an expert at hiding my secret.
No, this can't,
I became a war hero and raised a family.
They're gonna undercut this, aren't they?
But I was dying inside. And the deeper I buried it, the more unhappy I became.
I had no idea.
And my story, to one degree or another, is every transgender person's story. And all those stories are the price of admission to finally feeling at peace with who you are. A price you never paid.
I'm so sorry, Ida.
What the fuck?
So naturally, the moment I saw this, I cleared my schedule, canceled my meetings, told my wife that I probably won't make it to our firstborn son's birth, and started work on a video about the evolution of transgender representation in one of television's longest-running comedies. Because who else is going to do it? It's not like I'm stuck in a saw trap where my only way out is to make a video about Family Guy and I'm tired of trying to gnaw my ankles off to escape an ironclad shackling. That'd be crazy. So let's get this over with. Might as well start from the very beginning while we're at it. Ah, the 2000s, the decade where 90% of television writers thought, hey, you know what's funny? Transgenders. Not that our group's very existence hasn't been mined for cheap comedy for literal decades. One could make an argument that 90s media was even more openly transphobic through films like Silence of the Lambs and Ace Ventura, but growing up in the 2000s and watching several of these shows throughout my childhood and teenage years, the decade does feel a lot more brazen and edgy in its mockery of the LGBT community than many remember.
The principals are tranny!
Why pay more to sit next to old tranny claws over there?
You think I'm gonna stick you with some toothless tranny from the Port Authority?
They tore my Captain Granny dress and called me a hot and tranny mess!
See, sexual harassment is an umbrella term. It doesn't just cover women, but also men and transgender individuals.
Maybe it's that gay people were now kinda sorta almost normalized among liberal circles, so television writers had to find a new easy target for cheap laughs. Maybe it was the influence of South Park, a show that I have not watched a single episode of, but know was infamous for causing a trend of mean-spirited shock humor in mainstream comedies. Maybe it was 9/11, Joy is Dead, Cynicism is In. Shows that I otherwise love, like The Simpsons or Arrested Development or Futurama, had entire episodes or subplots hinging around concepts of men pretending to be women to date lesbians, or so-called trans women with raspy voices hitting on young men, or men transitioning into women to get an advantage in women's sports. I have a hard time even blaming individual writers or showrunners in a lot of these cases because this type of humor was just omnipresent at the time. Some of these very same shows that are still going have evolved their humor from mocking trans people to being vaguely supportive or at the very least not unsupportive to our plight, with the key distinction that very few have acknowledged or attempted to atone for previous transphobic tendencies. The Simpsons has done some pretty good episodes episodes in recent memory that explore previously brushed aside topics like Smithers' sexuality or Carl's race in a nuanced and interesting way, but they've yet to feature a transgender character who isn't just the butt of a joke.
Hi, Marge. I was just taking Stan Lorena to get her hormone shots.
And that's where Family Guy comes back in, a series I do have experience with, as shown by how often I meme about it on this channel. This show also had a transphobia episode. This show has also made transphobic jokes in countless gags and cutaways. This show also has the reputation for being a crass, mean, equal opportunity offender. And yet, this show also has a transgender character who isn't just a one-off, who's related to a main character, who's received multiple spotlight episodes and moments throughout the years, who the writers have attempted to give actual nuance and depth to. A character who debuted on May 9th, 2010 in Season 8, Episode 18, Quagmire's Dad. Oh boy. Now, Quagmire's Dad is an episode that has been discussed ad nauseum in analyses of anti-trans comedy of the era. I'm not gonna spend too much time recounting it. So, the father of lovable sex offender Quagmire returns to Quahog, reveals that he's a transgender woman who is returning to get a sex change operation and to legally change her name to Ida. Quagmire is embarrassed, the family is really mean to her, and Brian, who was out of town during this, comes home and sleeps with her, only to find out that she's trans afterward, and then he's really disgusted and gets in a wacky fight with Glenn that ends with,
"Hey, I f- your dad."
Pretty typical for this era of the show, pretty typical talking points about why trans people are funny and cringe and disgusting to everyone else. LOL, Brian is barfing for a minute straight. It's funny because it goes on for a long time. Actually, wait, I'm one to talk. I'm really one to talk. Listen, I'm not, like, deeply offended by these types of jokes. They're gross, lazy, and make me roll my eyes, but whatever. I'm an adult. However, a large amount of Family Guy's audience is teenagers, and while I'm not saying that this crass cartoon is supposed to educate our youth about nuanced topics of gender and sexuality, I do personally just hate that this was definitely many people's first introduction to trans people as a concept. The idea that there were likely thousands of cis and trans teenagers internalizing the content of this gleefully vitriolic and misinformed episode is just kind of a bummer. My introduction to the concept of trans people was through a joke in a Smosh video calling Megan Fox's character in Transformers a transvestite. I didn't actually know that being trans was a legitimate, perfectly fine thing until 2014. I had never even seen an actual video of a trans woman until I was 15. It's hard to become comfortable with yourself when your first exposure to the type of people you identify with is people throwing up at the idea of having sex with you, or outdated concepts of the sex change process being this instantaneous and easily accessible process. Beyond all of the misinformation and trans panic jokes and bordering on slurs, there are actually a few elements of this episode that I do find interesting for other reasons. First, unlike the stereotype of the predatory trans woman, Ida is shown to be a genuinely nice person. She's never combative to the Griffins, never portrayed as malicious, she's even pretty empathetic to Quagmire's discomfort about the situation, and they're able to come to a kinda understanding by the end, even if he still calls her his dad. In a more nuanced satire, the jokes would probably be about how everyone else is being terrible when she's just vibing. More recent comedies like Big Mouth and Season 10 of Curb Your Enthusiasm have done this, in my opinion, pretty well. Yet, despite Ida's kind-heartedness, we're supposed to laugh along with the character speculating about her genitals, making fun of Quagmire, and throwing up after having sex with her. It makes this already mean episode feel cruel, even by this show's standards. Like, at least when they started dumping on Meg more, they made her more of a bitch to compensate. I can't believe I'm using that as a positive comparison.
I like the outfit you have on.
Thank you, Meg. Who did your procedure?
Wow, you just burned your last friend in this room, lady.
Second, and much more pertinently though, according to Seth MacFarlane, and you will not believe the emotions I felt upon finding this out, Steve Callaghan, a writer on Family Guy, had a parent who transitioned from male to female, and the story was based on his own experience. I'm sorry, what? 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 I don't want to speculate on their personal life, but I had to bring it up because, Seth, I know you brought this up to make the episode look better, but does this not make it look a little bit worse that a writer of the episode, not the main writer, but apparently a writer, basically broadcast their disgust at a parent's transition to the entire world? Men will literally write a transphobic Family Guy episode before going to therapy. All of this is to say that Ida had some really bizarre context around her, and it makes me shocked that she stuck around as a recurring character. A tangential family member who was only briefly visiting town could have been written off the show so easily, but unlike the vestiges of transphobic comedy in other shows which were largely swept under the rug once cultural attitudes begin to shift, Ida Davis has appeared or been mentioned in 33 episodes to this date. I skimmed through all 33 of her appearances. They ranged from background roles to jokes about Brian being gross to jokes about trans people being weird to the occasional supporting role in a Quagmire storyline. Most of it was pretty minor and about what we've come to expect. It wasn't until 2019, with the 17th and 18th seasons, that they began to give her more spotlight again, and nearly 10 years later, around the time of those aforementioned interviews, is where the tone began to drastically shift. So, I don't know if y'all have heard, but Family Guy is woke now. Meg isn't dumped on as often. Quagmire isn't a literal fucking rapist anymore. They're phasing out the gay jokes, apparently. And yes, Ida is a character now portrayed with some pathos. That speech I showed from the beginning comes from season 17, episode 13, Trans Fat, where Peter pretends to be transgender and hijinks ensue. Get it? Trans fat? He's trans and fat. Funny! Okay, I will say that the inciting incident of the episode did get a chuckle out of me. Peter really has to go to the bathroom at a Red Sox game, so he unknowingly uses the transgender restroom, prompting the Fenway Park Jumbotron to spotlight Peter as the first ever transgender fan of the Red Sox.
I saw a mouse.
Anyway, this makes everyone in Quahog think Peter is trans, and his workplace starts offering him transgender healthcare benefits, which he wants to take advantage of, so he leans into it, goes on a makeover montage, says mean things to the guys because social etiquette says they can't hit him, and in general is really annoying. The portrayal of people treating him nicer after coming out as trans is weird, but I guess I get the satirical point they're going for, liberal allies going a bit too far in their supportiveness. Sure, certainly a better concept than Quagmire's dad, not that it's a high bar. Where the episode really goes off the rails was when Peter gets injured, taken to the hospital, and while comatose, given a vaginoplasty that he earlier requested as part of his scheme. In the character's perspective, actually making him a woman. Cue montage of jokes of what women be like, Peter's friends wanting nothing to do with him now, etc. Depressed, Peter eventually goes to the amazingly named LGBTQ Fridays and meets up with Ida, where she gives him this incredibly dramatic speech that I showed in the intro, lambasting Peter for making a mockery of trans struggles and encouraging him to return to his former self.
You know nothing about what it means to feel this struggle.
Yeah, you're right. I kind of stumbled into all this, but you've been dealing with it your whole life.
Again, weird. Not just because of the obvious hypocrisy on the part of the writers, I'll get to that, but also because this speech and the premise of the episode as a whole, it's transmedicalist. Probably not intentionally so, but still transmedicalist. For those who aren't aware, transmedicalism is basically the idea that only those with government-approved gender dysphoria and those who fully undergo every stage of the gender transition process are true transes, and those who don't feel dysphoria, don't undergo certain aspects of transition, or don't want to fall into the rigid gender binary are fake transes. You could say that's an oversimplification, but I do not respect their viewpoint enough to go into more detail. The idea that those darn trans trenders are making us real transes look worse to the masses and it's taking away our rights is dumb cis-normative nonsense that doesn't make sense if you think about it for more than half a second. So Ida's speech essentially amounting to I went through the suffering to be trans and get accepted and you didn't, and Peter's scheme essentially amounting to pretending to be trans for free perks because it's trendy and fun, it's misguided at best. On one hand, I highly, highly doubt that the Family Guy writing room knows that this intra-community debate even exists. I honestly think they just wanted to attach a typical Peter identity scheme to a topical political group, and while they were at it, brought in Ida to force the episode's resolution and subtly make up for past indulgences, even if they won't admit to that second part. I think it's telling that a lot of the jokes in the episode are about Peter being a woman and the gender stereotypes that come with it, rather than Peter being trans specifically, at least up until the end. On another hand, it's still not a great message to have, especially when Family Guy has made jabs at those kooky non-binary kids before, too. Looking at the YouTube comments of the video does show that a lot of people with this attitude are latching onto this episode, and I think that shows how a not fully thought out satire can bring out the worst messages for people, almost the same as how Quagmire's dad might have influenced people's views on trans people 9 years earlier. Unrelated, but the comments on this video are absolutely amazing, holy shit.
This is not suitable for children. Absolutely shameful they're putting this stuff in cartoons.
That woman is a dude.
This scene is the best way to explain the difference between legit trans people and gender special attention seekers who identify as some 100th gender.
There's no such thing as being born in the wrong body. But since this is a cartoon, it works here.
Fuck yeah, Family Guy. Flag emoji, transgender emoji.
I'm trans, and I can relate a lot to what Ida said. This scene was so well done, the best they've done in years. And what Ida said to Peter is what needs to be said to these SJWs faking being transgender today. Great episode.
Why did Family Guy go downhill?
I think the larger issue with this episode is that, while I'm at least glad they tried, this seems sincere going by the music cues and none of the jokes downplaying it too much. I also find it very confusing, because literally almost every other Ida appearance I sat through very much did not care about this angle to the character at all. She barely even has a character, if I'm being honest. The drama entirely came from other characters being made uncomfortable by her, so to suddenly pull out this dramatic backstory, one that was apparently floating around unacknowledged in all of her past appearances, it might have been an attempt to do right, but it kinda makes the writers and characters look even worse. That the concept of playing a queer character straight was even an option further pulls into question why it was played so ridiculously and unsympathetically in the first place. Again, apparently this was based on a true story. The sudden shift in tone feels less like an attempt at expanding upon the prior portrayal, and more like an attempt at ignoring it or downplaying it or erasing it. Because if it wasn't, you're basically admitting to having joyfully mocked the experience of a suffering character. I know it's Family Guy, which will have Peter sing a song about a guy having AIDS for the ironic contrast, but black comedy is much easier to swallow when it's confined to a one-off gag, and Ida was way too far from being a one-off gag for this type of shit to work. Maybe if they were to, like, basically remake Quagmire's dad, but with an actual character arc for Brian where he learns not to be ashamed of sleeping with a trans woman and where Ida herself has actual feelings on the matter, they'd be able to have their cake and eat it too a bit more. Have your dumb shock humor, sure, I honestly do not care. Just to try to give it some actual commentary or satire or character development while doing it. Seth MacFarlane did say in that interview that he wouldn't make any big changes but would maybe modify a few individual jokes. Maybe that could make for a not terrible episode of television. Wait, they did that? And it is a not terrible episode of television? And it came out shortly after Trans Fat? What the deuce? The very next appearance of Ida came later that same year with Season 18, Episode 2, Brida. After some boring, unrelated Act 1 that ends with a sex tape of Quagmire leaking or whatever, Brian and Ida bump into each other at a bar where Brian comforts her through her embarrassment, Ida admits that she was initially drawn to Brian due to his wisdom and loyalty, and Brian admits that he was a bit close-minded about the idea of a relationship in the past. They get a room, sleep together, and Brian realizes he's not freaked out. He's doing okay. Could it be?
I guess I'm just not as hung up as I used to be.
Room service?
Oh my god, you ordered room service? Are you crazy? What if somebody finds out I'm in here having goofball sex?
Oh, that's an annoying way to undercut a potentially nice moment. If only they were to acknowledge this in the episode. Wait, they did. The very next scene is Ida mentioning that Brian only seems to take her on dates to faraway places. I don't love the joke of the waiter not knowing which one is the lady, but it's pretty tame by this show's standards, and there is a pretty funny cutaway gag after that.
It just seems like you're always taking me to out-of-the-way places to avoid being seen together. Like yesterday. Come on, that's not true. I just wanted to show you a beautiful view. Wow.
Brian then actually apologizes, outwardly states that Ida is his new girlfriend, tells the family, and they lampshade how different the cultural environment is now.
I know Brian was squeamish about sleeping with a trans woman before, but it's 2019 now.
Yeah, things that were gross 5 years ago are now heroic.
Now again, don't love that joke, but there actually are some jokes related to Ida being trans that I don't hate in this one.
I'm not seeing an Ida Davis.
Try Dan Quagmire. Lieutenant Dan Quagmire.
Ah, the lieutenant. And how's he doing? Still have his penis?
No, he doesn't. And that's a weird question to ask.
I'm a weird guy. I work at a museum.
Like, yeah, I can admit there are some parts of the trans experience that are awkward and absurd and funny from the outside, jokes that don't have to come at our direct expense. Now, it's not, like, a good episode. The plot loses me a bit when it becomes about Quagmire finding out about the relationship and being against it. I don't love the Quagmire and Brian rivalry in general. There are a few silly moments, like Quagmire inexplicably being obsessed with Night at the Museum, and I do kind of like Brian genuinely trying to be a nice stepfather to him. It just falls apart with a status quo ending where Quagmire makes Ida choose between Brian and him, and of course she chooses her son. It's so unsatisfying, just this terrible character being a dick and getting what he wants and then the episode is over.
Excuse me, ma'am, no porn at the bar.
Oh, it's okay, I'm transgender.
Oh, I had no idea.
do whatever you want all the time.
What universe do the Family Guy writers think we live in? Aside from the crappy ending and several crappy jokes, however, this really does feel like a more genuine follow-up to Quagmire's dad than the other episode. It even has the same writer, not the one with a supposed trans mother, but the same writer nonetheless. Instead of shoving in a misguided message that is directly antithetical to their previous betrayals and completely breaks the tone, they directly acknowledge the shitty way it was portrayed in the past, showed at least one character growing past it, and found some ways to mine humor out of it without just spreading misinformation or being cruel. Honestly, I... Hear me out. Why didn't they just keep Brian and Ida together, honestly? Listen, I get it. Family Guy is a status quo show, but comparing the first 20 seasons of The Simpsons to the first 20 seasons of Family Guy, the latter has done quite a few more status quo changes than the former. They've even done multi-episode arcs about Brian before, even if one of them is, well...
Brian, look out!
And if they kept Brian and Ida together, it'd simultaneously address several of the issues the writers have acknowledged having in recent years, and open them up to some new stories. They realize that Quagmire being a sex offender isn't going to fly in a post-Me Too world, so now he just has no character, really. But if they mind this awkward stepfather role he has with Brian, there's a new comedic bent right there. He's just a weirdo with mommy issues, jokes ensue. If they really want to show that Ida is a real sympathetic character, I don't know, having her in a committed relationship with a main character wouldn't hurt. I can't believe I'm writing fucking Family Guy fanfiction at the conclusion to this video, but this is where I'm at. See, unlike something like South Park, which also used recurring transgender characters as a punching bag with creators that are openly conservative, Seth MacFarlane is a liberal. Granted, he's barely involved in the show anymore, and liberals aren't exactly guaranteed to not be transphobic as shown by some hacks, but nonetheless, as the political tides change, Family Guy's acceptable targets and practices have changed as well. The most notable example being when Mike Henry stepped down from voicing Cleveland in 2020 so that African-American voice actor Arif Zaire can voice the character instead. Which is cool, but it's also very funny. Like, dude, the Cleveland show went on for 4 seasons and you only just realize this now? You literally still voice So this isn't me trying to call out the Family Guy writers or say you're a bad person if you like the show. I don't love or hate Family Guy. I just think about it a lot.
Peter.
It's just interesting, you know? The fact that Quagmire's dad was based on true life experiences and wasn't meant to be hateful is revealing. The fact that Trans Fat tried to have it the other way and play trans rights for drama is comical. And the fact that Bryda basically redid the events of a past episode but with slightly less cruelty is interesting. They may say that they stand by their past work, and maybe they do, but the shifting tides of who it is and isn't acceptable to punch down on are going to change nonetheless. It gives me the tiniest iota of hope that maybe in another 10 years, trans humor can just be humor. Not jokes about how gross we are, but also not putting us on a pedestal where we can't make jokes about our own experiences either. Just a group of people existing. I'm really struggling to come up with a satisfying conclusion for all this. I'm not Toonerific Tariq. I'm not good at writing about Family Guy. Why did I choose this topic? To wrap things up, Seth, if you ever get insecure about playing a trans woman in the same way Mike Henry got insecure about playing a black man and need to pluck another voice actor off of YouTube to replace the role, I'm right here. Today I'll be giving a shout-out to my patrons at the producer tier and above, those being Ace L, ArcadeFlower190, Chloe BC, Joy Content, Oliver Kirkorin, Oski, Sam, and Vincent Coates. With that said, I hope you all have a wonderful day, and I will see you all later.